This is a distinct honor to have Ambassador Kumar here. We're going to call him up in a minute to discuss the relations between India businesses and the United States. We're very proud and honored to have such a wonderful turnout today and appreciate all the leaders that have come together, our board members, as well as President Eisler, and faculty members. And it is, again, a distinct pleasure to call up Ambassador Kumar to share some words.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Dr. Fleischman, for that kind introduction. It is a pleasure for me to be present here amongst all of you. I thank the World Affairs Council of Western Michigan and the Ferris State University, which is co-hosting the event, for bringing us together. I will be sharing my thoughts about the partnership between India and the United States of America, two countries which are democracies, large markets, large economies. Countries which respect the rule of law, respect innovation and the spirit of entrepreneurship, and which also share convergences on some major global issues. Many commentators and political leaders have spoken of India-US partnership, of having the potential to be the defining partnership for the 21st century. Our two countries enjoy wide-ranging cooperation. It would not be an exaggeration to say that today it encompasses all aspects of human endeavor. So as I speak about India-US relations, I'll also touch upon the India story as to what is happening in India, what are the type of initiatives that we are taking to grow, to make to have a more sustainable, equitable development back home. We view the United States as a very important partner in a quest to transform our economy and for our development. But equally important, I would say that India is a partner that you can count on, and I think importantly, a player whose scale, the size and economy would also be important for global good. Last year was an exceptionally tough year for all of us. India was no exception, no part of the globe was untouched. And as COVID-19 disrupted global supply chains and contracted economies, we also suffered. But I think, if looking back, I think the lessons that we draw from COVID, first of all, the indomitable spirit of mankind, the fact that governments, scientists, healthcare workers, businesses, and civic society all coming together to sort of beat back the pandemic, and with the successful vaccines and ongoing vaccination drive, I think there is cause for optimism, for renewal, for recovery and growth. Turning to India-US relations, I think if you look at our trajectory of our relations over the past 20 years, it has been consistently moving forward. We enjoy close political contact. In fact, the Prime Minister of India was recently in Washington, D.C. He had extensive discussions with President Biden. He also attended the first in-person Quad meeting, which brought together leaders of Australia, Japan, India, and U.S. together. Very briefly, the two leaders agreed to further sort of strengthen a comprehensive strategic partnership to work with regional groupings like ASEAN and Quad, and they also discussed how ways to bolster bilateral trade and commercial linkages, strengthen our security and defense partnership, strengthen and advance our clean energy partnership, and explore new avenues in areas such as new and emerging technologies, in R&D, in innovation, and so on. So what I'll do is, I will try and focus my attention to five key areas where we will certainly see closer relationship with the United States. First, we will continue seeing intensive cooperation in COVID-19 management and healthcare, affordable vaccine development and delivery. A second category would be digital cooperation. We are likely to see, in fact, accelerated growth when it comes to digital technology, artificial intelligence, machine learning, Industry 4.0 and related technologies. A third basket would be the energy basket. Both our countries are committed to combating climate change, so cooperation in green technologies and pathways that help us on a low carbon pathway in the future. Fourth category is what I describe as the knowledge partnership, linkages between higher education institutes, universities, science and technology and research institutes, and startups, incubators, and so on. And lastly, fifth, our traditional cooperation in strategic and defense areas, including in the Indo-Pacific, will grow. So I'll briefly take up these broad baskets of cooperation one by one. So if you look at the health cooperation, we, India and the United States, have a 3-decade-long partnership on health research, and we have collaborated to combat diseases like tuberculosis, HIV, AIDS, eye diseases. We have also developed vaccines in the past for tropical diseases in India and Africa. So it was not a surprise that when COVID struck, the ICMR, the Indian Council for Medical Research, and the Center for Disease Control were in close contact and exchanging notes on the transmission of this disease, the diagnostic aspects, the therapeutic aspects, and so on. In fact, during the recent visit of the Prime Minister, the two sides have signed an overarching MOU on health cooperation and biomedical science to help better prepare for future pandemics. It also covers things like genome surveillance and so on. When it comes to the United States, we supply around 40% of generic medicines sold in this market, and that accounts for almost $90 to $100 billion of savings for medical expenditure here. For COVID-19 vaccination, the Bill Gates Foundation, Gavi Alliance, supported by Quad countries, have joined hands with manufacturers in India to supply up to 1.1 billion doses of COVID-19 vaccines at a rate of around $3 per dose to around 100 low-income and middle-income countries. So that resumption of exports will begin from India this month. Today, we are fairly confident in terms of the COVID situation in India. We have 70% of our adult population have received at least one dose. So we are fairly confident that we can simultaneously start exporting vaccines again. In terms of opportunities in healthcare sector, we had launched in 2018 a major health insurance program covering 500 million people. So far, 200 million people have been enrolled. And this initiative, when coupled with last mile strengthening of health infrastructure and telemedical consultations, will transform healthcare in India. It also opens up opportunities for US companies in areas such as pharmaceuticals, basic research, vaccines, diagnostics, medical devices, and so on. Turning to climate change. We are, of course, Prime Minister Modi himself is quite committed to climate change issues, and we are taking practical steps across various sectors of economy, energy, transportation sector, agriculture, and so on. But if you look at how, after the Paris Treaty came into effect, how different countries have fared, you will find that India figures among the top 10 countries on the climate change performing index. We are also among the very few countries which are meeting their targets and actually have achieved more than what was intended. And I think in that respect, we are exceeding our target of 175 gigawatts in renewable energy by 2022. We hope to achieve 220 gigawatts, and we have set a new target of 450 gigawatts by 2030. Similarly, for electric vehicles, our target is to have around 30% of vehicles on roads to be electric by 2030. Now, this is a big target, but you need to keep in mind that in India, 86% of vehicles are two-wheelers. So I think our focus will be there. While the ecosystem that we are developing will, of course, cater to four-wheelers and public transport, so I think the second big focus will also be on fleet of public buses that we have all across India. And entities in India, we are major suppliers of automotive components to automotive manufacturers in India, so that transition has also started taking place. We are supplying a lot of components that go into electric vehicles in the US, so that is already happening. During the recent visit and meeting of the Prime Minister, President Biden acknowledged the role of mobilizing finances for developing countries to meet their climate change targets, and the two countries have set up a clean energy agenda partnership. It's a decade-long 2030 partnership, decade-long partnership where we will be touching and bolstering collaboration on various fronts. We were already doing battery research in battery technology, storage technologies, trying to find to help transition from a liquid state battery to a solid fuel battery, and we are making some progress, but it's a few years ago, but that ongoing research between our two countries is exceedingly important. We have also launched the India-US Ocean Dialogue. We have also increased the share of liquefied natural gas in our energy mix. And over the past 5 years, our imports of shale gas and LNG from US have climbed from zero to a cumulative total of $28 billion. So moving forward, that would be another important area of trade. I will now turn my focus to our economic and commercial linkages. So when you look at trade, of course, there was a initial dip in 2020 due to COVID, but trade figures for 2020 ended up very close to where we were in 2019. Trade figures for this year show that we will be easily crossing the figures for 2019. And from the year 2000 to 2019, our trade has grown at a cumulative annual growth rate of over 11%. So there is a lot of synergy, there is a lot of opportunity, and all the underlying factors which had propelled trade over the past two decades continue to be relevant. Of course, we have to set higher ambition. Leaders have talked about a $500 billion trade and so on. So that would be the effort when the bilateral trade policy dialogue and the strategic economic dialogue happens in the next few months, what we need to do to tap into that potential. Talking of Midwest, I just wanted to mention that our trade in 2020 actually exceeded 2019 figures. So this was only this region. The rest of the regions in the US saw a dip in trade. And I think, I don't know the reasons for it, but I think some of the supply disruptions that took place in manufactured goods were met by additional exports from India. Our trade with the US Midwest is not too big, it's around $12 billion, but we did meet some of the demand from this part of the world. So talking of disruptions in global supply chains, I think there is an opportunity for India. We need more resilient and trusted supply chains, and we see an opportunity. Under the Atmanirbhar Bharat mission that we have launched, we are trying to scale up our manufacturing capacity. Government has rolled out production-linked incentive schemes for 14 sectors, and these incentives are worth $36 billion. In the last financial year, we also received around $81 billion of FDI into India. So I think part of it went into financial services, the major segment was technology. All four major technology companies in the US have placed rather ambitious plans for investment into India, and they were also instrumental in realizing this figure of $81 billion last year. The startup ecosystem in India is booming. In part, I think there has been a concerted focus of the government. For the first time, there was a nodal officer appointed at federal government level to look into this sector. We have this year close to, I think, 30 unicorns. We had 11 unicorns coming out of India last year. And the interesting fact is that these startup companies which have done well are looking at US as the second market. So once they, when they are looking at opportunities outside India, they're not looking in the neighborhood, they're not looking at Southeast Asia, they're looking at the United States. And similarly, studies have shown that when startup companies from the US are looking to expand their business, they're also not looking in the North American market or EU. They're actually directly moving to India because they see opportunity for growth. In the knowledge-based partnership area, I'll just focus on one sector, which is the higher education sector, and I do wish to carry forward this conversation with colleagues from the Ferris State University. But very briefly, last year, Government of India basically overhauled our overall education policy. This policy came after a gap of 34 years, so it was certainly very timely. And the education policy is actually trying to reimagine the ways in which our university system has functioned so far. Of course, objectives will not surprise you, because the American university system, I think maybe we have drawn lessons from some of the themes from here. So among its objectives is to expand the role of the university from a place to simply impart education, but also to serve as a hub for the broader community around itself, making the curriculum more flexible, in tune with the latest developments in industry or respective areas, introducing a culture of multidisciplinary studies instead and moving away from silo-based approaches, incentivizing research. So far, this has been an area which has lacked attention, and is strengthening the interface between academia and industry. So I think the other big focus in the education policy is that it provides greater flexibility to universities to explore international collaboration. If you see the current landscape, you'll find that international cooperation with foreign universities are basically confined to student or faculty exchange. Now that those restrictions have been lifted, I believe universities will explore ideas for curriculum development or a joint degree program, joint research, and eventually leading to possibility of opening of branch campuses for US universities in India. It will surprise you that as of today, there is only one university in the US, the University of Washington in St. Louis, that has a joint degree program with Indian Institute of Technology in Mumbai, one university. So I am really hopeful that with a revised framework in India, I think our industries will be interesting. In fact, that is my initial feedback from some of the universities that I have spoken, and they are looking at US universities very closely. Now turning to the strategic and defense cooperation. So in addition to the regular consultations that the two foreign officers have, we also have the 2+2 dialogue, which brings together the foreign and defense ministries together. India and US have also signed what are called the foundational agreements with the US. These include logistics exchange memorandum, it includes an agreement on communications, it includes agreement on security of industrial defense industrial information, and the basic exchange and cooperation agreement. Now, these four foundational agreements pave way for a more deeper and substantive defense exchanges and relationship. India has also been designated as a major defense partner by the United States and has been accorded a strategic trade authorization 1 status by the U.S. Department of Commerce. Our defense trade now stands at $21 billion in a short span. And if you were to contrast this with, say, 2008, you will find that our cumulative defense trade till that point was less than $500 million. So from there to $21 billion is really quite extraordinary. We are also now collaborating in joint R&D and innovation on the defense side. So we have a mechanism called the Defense Trade and Technology Initiative, which looks at these areas. And I think they recently have launched an initiative on air-launched drone. So they will be working on that project. But there are many other projects in the pipeline. There are also a number of established service-to-service exercises, including a tri-services exercise. And over the years, these military exercises have grown in scale and complexity. In the last decade, our maritime surveillance capability has improved with acquisition of P-8I from the United States. Similarly, our acquisition of transport planes from the U.S. have helped us extend our ability to render humanitarian assistance, not only within India, but also regionally when it comes to disaster relief operations. India and U.S. Continue to work closely to ensure free, open, and inclusive Indo-Pacific. We are working together to combat global terrorism. There are ongoing consultations on Afghanistan, maritime security, anti-piracy efforts near the Gulf of Aden, improving infrastructure connectivity in the Indo-Pacific, and strengthening capacity for humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. I will just take a couple of minutes to also talk as to why the U.S. Midwest region is important for us. So I think for us, the strengths of the region and its experience both are important. So as you know that this region sort of lagged behind when, after having propelled U.S. economy in the post-World War II period, lagged behind when the economy transitioned to a more services-led economy and subsequently to a more knowledge-based economy. But what we find interesting is how the U.S. Midwest is sort of reinventing itself, how it is repositioning itself as a hub for advanced and smart manufacturing, building on its traditional strengths, marrying technology and innovation, so electric mobility, autonomous vehicles, drones, or is emerging as a hub for startups in B2B space and pharmaceuticals, biohealth, and healthcare sector. We also find that the region has utilized locational advantages and available resources to develop niche technologies. So for example, wind energy or advanced clean water technologies where Minnesota leads the way, or IT-enabled services in agricultural sector or ag tech and so on. And of course, this region has its share of top-ranked top-ranked universities and cutting-edge research facilities. So I think there is immense synergy and potential for collaboration between India and the Midwest and some of the areas that I have talked about. If you look at Michigan, it has a very, very a strong base for manufacturing sector, a very strong base for aerospace and defense engineering. It has done well on the green, what is called the Green and Lean Mobility Pact in this state. It is a major hub for medical devices. So when it comes to Michigan, and of course, as I said, university cooperation, so all these provide us a lot of opportunities to explore to deepen cooperation with India. One last point I would like to make is that the nine states that I cover have around 600,000 people of Indian origin. And if you look at how the population of Indian Americans have shifted over the last decade, The Midwest registered the fastest growth and population. And I think Indian companies which are exploring new avenues for growth in the U.S. are also started looking more intently at the U.S. Midwest. So I think with that, I will stop here and look forward to the interaction. Thank you.